I was wondering if you could tell me, I mean, if you know.
Know what?
Well, if you know where it came from.
You know, I asked them that very same question once, and you know what they told me? Don't ask.
There's so much unexplored territory, and it seemed like the ceiling was so high, it was out of sight.
Because I remember we went through all kinds of gyrations trying to figure out how to do this darn water weenie.
T2, in my mind, is sort of the breakthrough film for computer graphics.
If you're not an artist, don't expect the computer to do it for you, because it ain't gonna do nothing. The computer does nothing. It's a tool.
So what's your story?
As an aficionado of visual effects from my fan days, even before I became a practicing filmmaker, I was always trying to stay abreast of what was being done in visual effects. Star Wars and motion control had really pretty much revolutionized visual effects. But then during the 80s, you saw CG really starting to develop, but it was always kind of a niche thing. It was used for certain types of animation that couldn't be done any other way, and it hadn't really been integrated into the mainstream of feature production.
A lot of stuff had been done up till then that was only partially successful or a very small number of shots or whatever.
When I started at ILM, what the computer graphics department was being used for was for stylized, non-realistic things.
We were still a long way from CG becoming an important player at that point.
The company needed something to gravitate around and that we could sort of prove the technology is either going to go somewhere or it isn't.
Well, as we began to work with computer graphics, it became apparent that, you know, almost anything that you wanted to do with it, there was a way to do it if you put enough time and effort into it.
There were kind of clues that would work, and there were plenty of people to say it wouldn't. And whenever that happens, I found that to be a sign of something.
We were in uncharted territory now, making up history as we went along.
When I wrote the sequence of the pseudopod in the abyss, I just saw what it should look like in my head, and I would do whatever was necessary to make that happen. We explored a lot of different ways of doing it, and we kept coming back to computer graphics animation as the most likely solution, but in a sense the scariest one.
Well, the big break for us on The Abyss was having a filmmaker who was willing to take, you know, a sort of substantial sequence and trust that, okay, we're going to do computer graphics for this. We're going to try a kind of relatively new technique that no one had really tried to use in this way before.
They had been doing enough R&D that they were ready to make the leap. They were ready to integrate a character in that way. And so they showed us some proof of concept, and we were off to the races. We were doing a film with The Abyss that was highly realistic in terms of the research and the production design, the sets, the actors. I mean, we certainly didn't pull any punches in terms of the attempt to do dramatic reality. So integrating a computer graphics effect into that was pretty scary because it had to look real. And not only had to look real, it had to look stunning. It had to look mind-blowing. So the bar was set very high.
Jim's one of the rare people to be able to, you know, work his script and direct his script around the available technology and to be able to sort of see the next step and take a chance on it. He's always a risk taker, and was being someone who would understand that it was going to be hard to do.
I recall it being sort of 10 or 12 months of hell getting these shots done, and it was like pulling teeth because the render times were so horrendously long.
Our entire computer graphics department had 900 megabytes of online storage. That was it. And we had to do the entire show with it.
So much had to be learned about refractive ray tracing and surface reflections and how you animate and how you take the facial data from the actors, which was done by laser scan, and how you animate with that, and how much of it is keyframe animation, and how much of it we actually had the actors do themselves. So there was quite a bit involved in it.
John Knoll came along with Photoshop, and it wasn't quite out yet.
The Abyss was the first feature film that Photoshop was used on it, and I spent a bunch of time in this very early version of Photoshop, kind of pasting all these things together, making these nice, just seamless reflection environments. Another thing that I did was for that first digital composite that in The Abyss with the door closing on the pseudopod and falling down and splashing on the floor, we had to have animated rotomats that had to be painted with soft edges, and I ended up just painting those in Photoshop.
It's, you know, digital comp that's all put in there, and, you know, just goes right by the audience. But it was, you know, one of the few examples up to that time of an all digital shot, and it brought everybody up to sort of a new level.
It was just a kind of dynamic convergence of elements, and so it just seemed like it fell into place at that point.
We proved we could do 16 shots in 5 months, whatever the thing was, on budget, pretty close. That was unheard of, to be able to do something like that.
And it was an image that you could tell just by looking at it that couldn't have been done with stop motion. It couldn't have been done with, you're seeing something new, and there was something, very exciting about that.
You're telling me that this thing can imitate anything it touches?
The concept of the liquid metal man was an idea that I had a good 10 years earlier when I had been just conceptualizing the first film. And there was no way to do it. Claymation was the only thing I could think of back in the early 80s. And I didn't think that was going to be mind-blowing enough. So when we got to the second film, the residue of that early idea was still floating around. But in the meantime, we'd done The Abyss. And so there was some proof of concept that some kind of liquid character could actually be done. That ultimately became the T-1000.
I think Jim, in the back of his mind, sort of possibly wrote it to just keep us, keep us thirsty all the time.
The T-1000 was an absolutely natural character for digital filmmaking and unnatural for any other kind of filmmaking. So Jim, I think, is the first major director to have created stories that are digital films.
The pseudopod in The Abyss, it was contained within a single sequence in the film. If it didn't work, push come to shove, we could have cut around it and bridged across it in some way and not lost the entire film. That was not the case with Terminator 2, because the T-1000 was throughout the film and he was integral to the understanding of the entire film. And so it really had to work there. So when we decided to go to the next level with the T-1000, we were really setting ourselves a challenge that was, again, an order of magnitude more difficult than the last time out.
This show was pretty terrifying for most people when it started up. The guys say, we can't do this yet, What are they trying to do? They can't do it.
I didn't go into the show relying on CG to be able to do it. I had a backup plan. I was ready at any time to start pulling out and get the model shop going and getting the foam being, whipped up and castings and everything like that if we had to, and try, other techniques to do it.
Well, it was definitely a leap of faith that we were going to hang the entire success or failure of a $100 million film on a relatively unproven technology and technique, and do so in a ridiculously short period of time.
I wouldn't have done T2 if it hadn't been for being able to get the digital compositing to work, because I knew that that the CG was unreliable in being able to produce perfect images every single time, and it took so long, so many iterations, to get rid of this little problem and that little problem. These problems may be only on there for two or three frames. And I got a Mac and art and right next to where I was, and Photoshop, and I think it was Doug Chang was in our art department, and he was my sort of what I call my secret weapon. And when an element of T2 worked up to a certain point and didn't work anymore, we were now in the digital world, he could paint the problem out.
So many of those CG shots with the T-1000, the background plates were actually shot before we shot the scene, because the schedule was so rigorous for them that we couldn't wait until we shot the scene in the shooting schedule. So we had to imagine what the scene was going to look like, build a set of just the background for that particular effect shot, whether it was a piece of floor, whether it was the elevator, or wherever we could contain it in that way, shoot all those plates in advance, agree on the lighting in advance, agree on the camera angle in advance, give them the plates, have them begin working on the visual effect shots, and then weeks or months later, we actually shot the scene that ran up to it and came after it. And somehow those shots had to drop right in.
What was special about Terminator 2 was this was the first time we were gonna marry these technologies. We were gonna marry live action puppeted effects with digital effects.
Stan Winston would start the effect, the CG would do the hard part, let's say one of the shotgun wounds healing or a head changing geometry in some way that a physical puppet couldn't do. And then he would carry on after that, where we had various types of rubber suits that had been vacuum metalized so that they were reflective as if they were liquid metal, and in quick cuts we got away with it. Given the fact that was the only way we could accomplish it in the schedule that we had available, I think it was quite remarkable. And I think it was amazing that we actually even took that chance.
I think in T2 we had about 47 or so CG shots. And yet the memory that people have of the film is it's a lot more than that. Well, it had some Stan Winston work that was just amazing, and it's the whole lead up, it's Arnold, it's Robert, it's everything that Jim did, the whole thing coming together, and then our effects in there.
You know, part of it was that every single frame of that computer animation was so costly that we really had to be stingy about how we used it, so which meant that we had to be clever in the way that we leveraged it so that we'd get the most impact.
It was the right time to do it. We were right on the edge of everything, technology, great story, great director. The team to bring this stuff to life was here at ILM. Everybody was focused on it. And we managed to, to pull it off. A lot of work in a reasonable amount of time that just hadn't been done before.
Cameron has always posed problems that have been interesting to solve, right? And that have been new. So it drove the industry.
What the fuck is it? What the fuck is going on?
T2 has been the one that the technology breakthroughs came through on, and the organization came together to be able to do it. We had all the components necessary to digitize film, manipulate it, and then go back out onto film again, which now everybody does, but at that time, it was, unheard of.
For this breakthrough work to be in a high-profile film certainly does a lot to catch people's attention and move things forward. We had first done morphing on Willow, but that didn't quite grab people's attention the way that the morphing in T2 did.
So this was the thing they remembered, and they attributed all the success to that, but really it's always a whole.
And suddenly it became kind of a fad. There was a 4-year stretch where you couldn't turn on the TV without seeing morphing in a television commercial.
Morphs had an impact on the market, and unfortunately so many of the satellite companies literally had a price list for it. Morphing, $35,
I think everybody always looks for a simple kind of one-stroke answer for why a film is successful, and this is always a mistake.
They see this and they get excited and they go, give me some of that. Can you give me some of that in my movie? But they don't really get it.
People thought, if I just make a film that's got those effects in it, it'll be successful, and that wasn't necessarily the case. People became fascinated by it, and that's okay, that's cool, that's fun, that helps establish the tools and make them available. But the things that interested me were not an emulation of that which had been done, but people that were using the tools in new ways.
T2 really got the company jazzed up about CG, but it didn't get the industry jazzed up, and I could never figure that out.
I think even after T2, CG still felt pretty experimental to me.
I think it was too hard to look at that shape-changing guy and saying, what else can it be? But it's a lot easier to look at a dinosaur and say, it could be another type of dinosaur, or it could be a dragon, or it could be maybe someday a person.
I think when I saw how they took what they had learned there and they applied it to what they did on Jurassic Park, that it really blew the doors off it.
A lot of people come to me and say, boy, that Jurassic Park was the breakthrough film, wasn't it? And I say, I don't think so. To me, Terminator 2 was the breakthrough CG film.
If we had not done The Abyss and if we had not done Terminator 2, we wouldn't have done Jurassic Park. And hence the industry would be 5 years behind.
We set the bar up to a new level and Jurassic Park moved it, but that was a very different thing. They weren't relying on something that had been done before. And then, Death Becomes Her did. And then after that, I think it started to branch out, and so many people were trying so many new things at that point that it really just exploded.
In a panic, they tried to pull the plug.
It was a convulsive time because you had so many people whose entire stock in trade was optical-based film effects.
The CG work we were doing was so foreign to everyone here that was kind of like its own thing and didn't really threaten anybody. But the digital compositing got a lot of people really worried.
There was a kind of big startup torque to getting the new computer-oriented digital composite people to really understand the tools that they had.
What T2 was is it gave a lot of people an opportunity to see how hard it was to do photoreal work.
Just because people had this tool set and this software didn't mean they understood anything about composite.
And they may not have the observation skills to be able to recognize when something doesn't look right when you cut it into the movie.
I found a whole bunch of really, really smart, stupid people who understood, code and understood higher math and understood software at a level that I couldn't begin to comprehend. But when it came to simple things like perspective, they didn't get it. And they couldn't understand why the shots weren't working. They should have worked. The math said the shot would work, but the shot didn't look real. Why not? How about perspective? How about aerial perspective? How about this? How about that? How about shadows? How about it now? All these subtle things that anybody who had a background in optical printing would understand.
We gave everybody from the original optical department a chance to be the first group in doing it. A lot of those guys have gone on to become some of our best people because they had a lot of experience in being able to judge colors and pick this and this and, get things to work really good. years of experience in that. And that has been a real advantage to some of the newcomers that came in.
On the other hand, the people that did opticals didn't want to learn or were slow in learning. So you had this gap in technique that became really obvious really quickly.
Every time there is a new technology, there is a paranoid faction of less than brilliant artists who feel that that's the end of their career, who don't understand that art never dies, that technology will go on and serve art, but art never dies.
Stan, to his credit, is one of the sharpest people that I know. And when the digital stuff came along, instead of getting afraid and clenching up and feeling invaded by it, he just leaped right over that fence and started embracing it right away.
Myself, I define myself as someone who wants to create characters. And I want to use whatever tool it is to create the most memorable character there is.
And the first thing he did was start putting in a bunch of workstations at his facility. And here's a guy who does rubber and hydraulics and all that, but he wanted to have this other capability as well.
The brilliant people in the field, the people like the Jim Camerons and the Steven Spielbergs and now the Peter Jacksons who understand the art of storytelling, use all the tools because it's foolish not to.
When Terminator 2 came out, and I saw that in the movies for the first time, I realized that as a filmmaker, I had to get involved in this new technology because otherwise I was going to be left behind. I mean, this was an incredible tool, you know.
I think it really opened it up to an almost infinite horizon.
It gave us ideas, took us in new directions. I mean, things we would have never...
The more processes that you can do in the digital realm, the better off you're going to be because there's no degradation. There's no generational loss. There's no scratching and dirt in the elements. Before, we used to edit image to image. Now we edit within images. And that's the ability to blow up and move and add camera movement and take out scratches and take out objects that you don't like in frame and take elements from one shot and put them into another shot and merge two takes together, all of these sorts of things that can be done. There's no such thing as pure sound. We don't hold a microphone out and record what's happening on the set and call that some sacred document that then must be preserved all the way through to the end. The second we get that production sound, we start trying to figure out ways to make it better, putting in sound effects, putting in music, cleaning it up, doing ADR. A lot of the dialogue is post-loop. Why would we think of the image as any different than that? Why would we think of the image as something that's fixed in amber at the moment that it's photographed and when it could be manipulated after the fact, as an artist would continue to overpaint a painting? It's an iterative process. It's constantly getting better and better and better, up to the limit of your ability to see what's wrong and manipulate it and make it better.
You know, before the digital technology existed, you could imagine all those things, and then the compromises would begin at that point. Okay, I can imagine, you know, a thousand soldiers storming the castle. Well, we're only going to have 30 extras, and it's a model castle, and we're somehow going to have to use, you know, matte paintings or forced perspective, and we're going to have to, you know, you can't have 1,000. There's no way. And
it used to be a situation where if you couldn't get somebody to do it, and you couldn't figure out a way to rig it so that it really happened in the real world, it wasn't going to be in your film. But now you can do it with essentially CG stuntmen, and the interaction with fire effects and water effects and everything has gotten sophisticated enough. If you can imagine it, you can accomplish it, and you can accomplish it safely. I think there's a way to do a shot in the real world. You try to do that. You look into it. If there's no way to do a shot in the real world, you do it as a digital shot. If you're going for a vision, you go after that vision first and foremost, and don't let the real world dictate to you.
Baby, this is going to blow them all away.
It's very hard to wow audiences now because I think there's an assumption that, oh, yeah, they just did that on a computer.
Anything you can imagine can now be put on the screen. And I think what that does, in a funny kind of a way, is it actually takes the emphasis off the special effect.
It's all right for audiences to take absolutely beautiful work for granted because it forces us as filmmakers to constantly go back to the human connection.
This year I've seen the most brilliant performance by an actor that I can remember for many, many years, and it's a completely digital character. That's the Gollum.
If a film is connecting on a human level, the audience doesn't really care how big or how spectacular things are.
It still boils down to the artist that's creating the character and creating the performance. Even that movie, though, there was digital characters, there were live action makeup characters, there was a mix, there was a blend, there was a world that was a constant blend of digital technology, miniatures, live action. It was magic because a brilliant director didn't rely on any one technology to tell his story.
Because the best films are films that have hundreds of different factors of storytelling and character and acting and camera style, all flowing together.
The computer technology becomes just another tool in the arsenal of the filmmaker, you know, a very, very potent one.
There's no fee but what we make for ourselves.
With these advances in the speed of computers and sophistication of software, you don't have to have a lot of money to start doing this stuff.
You can buy, you know, $40 worth of books at a bookstore and a couple of $1,000s in programs, and it can be one person, you know, working at his home doing it.
It enables anybody who's got an idea to be able to get that idea out.
And a lot of guys can, you know, can start on a Mac or a PC or Linux and come to us and get employed, or they can even do it, you know, in their own living room.
So yeah, it's been, I think, great for the effects industry that so many people have had a chance to dabble with this stuff and be able to demonstrate their talent.
Because anybody can use this technology and anybody can put these images up on screen. It's not new and original anymore. It's there for everybody to use. And so therefore the emphasis goes back on how you use it.
The tool isn't as important as the result. And as a filmmaker, I'd love to have the tools be cheaper and more democratized.
And I think that just actually swings the arc back to storytelling again. That special effects used to be the event, but now because they're so common, they're so easy to do with the digital technology, they're no longer the event. The event now becomes the story that you're telling.
And ultimately, I think that as long as people always make story and character the most important thing, and all of these other new arrows in the quiver secondary to that, then they're going to make good films.
Who's responsible?
I think Jim deserves a tremendous amount of credit. First of all, he had the vision, the imagination, and the creative ideas to write stories that used the expanded palette of digital filmmaking.
Jim Cameron is the ultimate pioneer in this arena. Not taking it away from anyone else, but Jim Cameron made the breakthroughs.
What he did here is essentially open up a whole new can of worms for the entire industry, you know, with Terminator 2.
I think that the issue is don't stop questioning and don't stop trying to figure out ways to push the ball further downfield.
Every show that you do, you're presented with some sort of new problem that needs to be solved. And, you know, once that problem is solved, it's available to all the other shows that follow.
A lot of them have come from just a few people with really sharp ideas, then leading all the other folks or showing the other folks sort of a way to do it. And everybody, and it changes. This person comes up with a great idea, and this one does here, and this one does here.
And I'm just glad that, you know, films like Terminator 2 kind of inspired me to get it going when I did, because it's really ultimately led to a growth of knowledge and experience that enabled us to do Lord of the Rings. I mean, we could never have even made that film if we hadn't been where we were at that time in regards to our CG experience.
People caught on to it and started doing some really pretty remarkable work, and we've never looked back. I mean, let's face it, as an industry, when you see something better, you glom onto it. You don't have to go out and sell it. People will find it.